Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everyone, and welcome to the 100th episode of Brains Matter. Yes, the Brains Matter podcast has hit the magical ton, or C in Roman numerals if you prefer. This 100th episode also coincides with National Science Week in Australia, of which the Brains Matter podcast is a participant of. So if you found the show through the National Science Week, a big welcome, and I hope you go back and listen to the other 99 shows as well.
Program Brains Matter is really taking off, a bit like a Saturn V rocket. And on this night where we're celebrating not only the 40th anniversary of the Apollo 11 landing, on this very day actually, for us it was 21st of July back in 1969, we're also celebrating within 5 days' time the 400th anniversary of the first telescopic map of the moon. So I think it's a momentous occasion tonight. And I wish you well with all your future endeavours. That's Andrew Prentice signing out.
Thank you, Dr. Prentice, for that, and we'll be hearing from him a little later on. There's been quite a number of suggestions on what I should do for the 100th show, from fun facts to the evolution of the show to highlighting the fun of science and mathematics. I'll see how I go.
This is Simon Singh, and this is the 100th episode of Brains Matter. Congratulations.
And in terms of the wonder of science and mathematics, Dr. Simon Singh, author of Fermat's Last Theorem, the Code Book, and a book on the Big Bang, amongst many other books, joins me to explain how interesting it really can be. So keep your ears out for that towards the end of the episode.
Hi, this is Dr. Ali Ford from Monash University. Well done on getting to 100 shows. Good luck in the future.
The show has gone through a lot of changes over the past 99 shows. Prior to episode 23, we also had a different theme song. There have been brain teasers, which I'll have to resurrect at some stage, and a host of fantastic guests. Remember this old theme song?
I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I thought I might be, for that's clear anybody to see. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I clever I would be, I'm not half as clever as me. I smart, I was thought, but I know I am not. Crow, I now know I'm eating like pie, an arrogant idiot high. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I thought I might be, for that's clear anybody to see. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I smart, I am. I'm not as think as I clever would be, I'm not half as clever as me. I brilliant, I was thought, and I guess I forgot. Clever for me is not a good thing, I really an idiot am.
Well, hopefully I've learned a few things since then, and we're all a bit smarter as a result. But if you thought September 2006 was when the seeds of Brains Matter were sown, you're not quite right. Just like archaeologists do with their study in trying to find origins of cultures, animals, plants and so on, I did a bit of forensic audio investigation into the origins of the show and found these examples from an FM radio broadcast from the mid-1990s. And that was U2 back from about 1983 with Sunday, Bloody Sunday. And that was a song written about Londonderry, 1972, deaths, IRA, British. But we won't go into that, will we? Because we're very neutral.
Yes, yeah. Extremely neutral.
As politics goes.
Give us a ring on 905-3129.
That's the number. And Christian, I have a little bit of information for you.
Ooh.
Have you ever wondered how the Greeks figured out the size of the Earth?
What, you mean they figured out how big it was?
Yeah. This was back in a long, long time ago.
How?
Well, here comes the hard name. Eratosthenes. If you know how to pronounce it properly, please tell us.
905-3129.
Eratosthenes, who lived around 250 BC, was the first man to know how to figure out the size of the Earth. He never travelled around the world, and he never had any measuring equipment, so how do you think he did it?
I have absolutely no idea.
Well, Eratosthenes, or I'll just call him the Greek man.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
The Greek man used Euclid's principles of geometry to solve the problem. First, he found out that at noon on the longest day of the year, the sun shone straight down to the bottom of a well in the Egyptian city of Syene. At the same time in Alexandria, the sun caused an upright post to cast a shadow on the ground shaped like a right-angled triangle. A triangle with, you know, right angle with 90 degrees, yep. And everyone knows that. But we've got to be educational because we might have 12-year-olds listening to our show, so we should be able to tell them
what
we're
talking
about.
We are an educational institution, after all.
Yes, absolutely. The Greek man then measured the other angles found on that triangle, you know, with the shadow and the pole and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then he determined that the lines formed by the post at Syene and the well at Alexandria were extended downward. They would form two sides of another right-angled triangle at the centre of the Earth. And then using geometry,
Wow. The
Greek guy proved that one angle of the second triangle is equal to one angle of the first triangle, or 1/50th of an entire circle, you know, using similar triangles and that sort of principle. This was back in 250
BC. You have a very good
BC
mathematical background here.
Oh, yeah, did 3 years of mathematics, so I should know about this sort of thing. And since the Earth's circumference between Syene and Alexandria formed an arc, that arc was also equivalent to 1/50th of the Earth's circumference. So the Greek guy knew the distance between Syene and Alexandria was 500 stadia. That's the unit of measurement they used then. And he multiplied that by 50 because it was 1/50th of the circumference of the arc,
yep.
And all that sort of thing. And I found that the distance around the Earth was 250,000 stadia, or around 24,670 miles. And that was his calculation, 24,670. Remember that for the moment.
Was he right?
You want to know how close he was? This was 250 BC, mind you.
Right.
Right now we know that the circumference of the Earth is 24,900 miles. So that means he was only 230 kilometres off.
He did his maths well.
Yes, and considering the Earth isn't a sphere, that is very well done, because he would have had to assume that the Earth was a sphere, which it's not, because it's actually shorter at the poles than it is at the equator.
Hmm.
And there endeth the lesson for today.
Wow. Silence in the studio as we digest these things.
But if you want to find out anything about anything else, then ask us and we'll see if we do know about it. And we talked about the Greeks working out the circumference of the Earth just before, and I mentioned a unit of measure called a stadia. And that sounds a lot like the word stadium, doesn't it?
Or stardate. But no.
No.
Bit of a science fiction edge on that.
I always wonder why you had pointy ears. But anyway, have you ever wondered why a sports arena is called a stadium?
No.
Well, in ancient Greece, the stadion was a unit of measurement, and it was equal to about 600 Greek feet, which is about 600 imperial feet at the moment.
Mm-hmm. So the feet sizes of Greeks and imperial people never grew in that period of time.
Oh, they weren't quite the same. No, we're getting sillier all the time. The Greeks thought that this 600 Greek feet measurement was a perfect distance for a foot race, so they came to use the word stadion for an arena built around a foot race track, which was originally one stadion long. The Romans later changed the word to stadium, with a U-M at the end instead of O-N, and later on the word became commonly used for sports arenas. And think about this. You have the MCG, right?
That's yep.
They all say that's one of the largest stadiums in the world.
Mm-hmm.
It currently holds around about 100,000 people, I guess. But the biggest stadium in the world is in Prague, Czechoslovakia, and its seating capacity alone is 240,000. And if you try and cram all the people standing up in there, you could probably get quite a few more.
Hmm.
So how's that?
How many feet is that?
240,000 multiplied by 2, which is 480,000 feet.
He is a mathematics whiz. Yes.
Why did you ask me that? Totally irrelevant. But anyway. Now that guy sounds familiar. And it appears that when I was younger, I didn't know quite how to pronounce Eratosthenes, and I probably still don't.
Incidentally, he was born in 276 BC in Cyrene, North Africa, which is now part of modern-day Libya. Anyway, you can see where the seeds of this show came from, and the philosophy of education for the masses continues to this day.
Hey there, this is Christopher Short, the ex-president of Victorian Skeptics. Congratulations, Brains Matter, on getting to your 100th episode. Perhaps you'll receive a letter from the Queen or something like that. Good on you.
Okay, let's take a bit of a trip down Brains Matter memory lane. We've covered many different topics on this show, and I'll go through just a few of them over the course of this episode. Brains Matter is heard in over 80 countries around the world, including on Science 360 radio from the National Science Foundation in the US, the Atheist Age program on 3RPP FM in Victoria, Australia, Citywide FM in Wisconsin in the US, and of course, via iTunes, the Brains Matter website, RSS feeds, and the podcatcher of your choice. A big hello to everyone who fits any of those categories, and a big thank you for listening. Anyway, to start the ball rolling, I'll start with a new interview. As most of you know by now, it's the International Year of Astronomy. The rationale is that it's 400 years since Galileo first pointed his telescope up to the heavens. But wait, he wasn't the first to do so. Who was, you may ask? I talked to Dr. Andrew Prentice from Monash University, who clears this up.
I'm here with Dr. Andrew Prentice from Monash University. It's the International Year of Astronomy, as everyone is well aware of. And one of the things that a lot of people have been talking about is that it's 400 years since Galileo first looked at the moon using the telescope. But Dr. Prentice, you were telling me that it wasn't actually Galileo who was the first person to use the telescope to look at the heavens.
That's right. In the last few years, we've become aware, or the public have become aware, in fact, that it was an Englishman called Thomas Harriot, on July the 26th in 1609, about 4 months ahead of Galileo, produced the very first map of the moon using a telescope. He had actually got his telescope from Holland. The Dutch should be using, starting to invent them, but more using them for sort of naval purposes. But Harriot was actually, he lived in London at that time, and at the Duke of Northumberland's house, at Sion House, and on 1609 he produced the first ever map, and over the subsequent 6 months he then produced much more detailed maps. But this was well ahead of Galileo, who didn't really start till November of that year. And it just so happens that his papers are kept in Petworth in West Sussex, where my PhD mentor finished up his days after he'd left Oxford. So I sort of feel I have a little connection there. And of course, Harriot was an Oxford student. It was a student at St. Mary's Hall, which no longer exists, has now been absorbed by Oriel College. Oriel claim him to be their student, but in fact the only known portrait we have of Harriot resides at Trinity Hall, and there's a picture showing him. He would have been about 30 at the time. Mm-hmm. He was a sort of gentleman, really. He just stayed as a bachelor, and he was very lucky to have all these wealthy friends, and like Northumberland. But he was associated with them, and they, of course, got caught up with this gunpowder plot, mm-hmm. which Guy Fawkes was planning to blow up part of London, I think, or London Bridge, I can't recall. And so as a result of that, Harriot he went to ground and he became obscure, and that's why he didn't want to tout the fact that he had invented this new instrument for looking at the heavens.
So that's pretty much the reason why for so long we thought that Galileo was the first person.
Yes, I think it was. Harriot's work was not published till about 1832, many years after.
That's over 230 years.
Yeah, it was something like 230 years later, but it was published.
Okay, well, that's fascinating to know. So all the people out there who are listening to this podcast, look up Thomas Harriot and look up Galileo. You can see some of the maps that he drew and compare them to some of the maps that Galileo drew. And they're both 1609, but you heard it here. Thomas Harriot beat Galileo to the punch. So we should actually be thanking Thomas Harriot for the 400 years since for the International Year of Astronomy, shouldn't we?
Indeed we should, and it's amazing that this 400th anniversary of Harriot map coincides almost to the day, to the 40th anniversary of Neil Armstrong stepping out on the moon of July 21 back in
1969. So it's an amazing convergence of events.
There's something in that for all of us, I think.
Yes, or something like that.
Okay, Dr. Prentice, thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you. So I have enjoyed being interviewed over the last few months by yourself.
Daniel Price from Monash. I'd just like to say congratulations on reaching 100 shows. Great achievement.
Now let's go right back to February 2007, where I interviewed Dr. Djoymi Baker on the relationship between modern science fiction and ancient Greek and Roman mythology.
People thought that's just science fiction, but today you have things appearing which reflect what they showed in the 60s series and back to Einstein's theories, like I don't know if you heard about the recent news, but about a particle that can vanish from one spot and reappear in another.
Yeah.
It's just a light particle at this stage.
But still.
Everyone, the first thing everyone said was, Star Trek has come to life.
Absolutely.
And the reference was Star Trek.
Mm. And I think there's a couple of things there. One is that science fiction often is prophetic because people are sort of thinking those big what-if questions. But also from the other point of view, if you've got these scientists coming up with new things, how do you sell that to a general public who may or may not have the technical knowledge in the really minutiae of what they're doing? Well, you tap into something pop culture like Star Trek and you say, well, you may not understand how this little particle gets from here to here or the mathematics of it, the science of it, but we'll use this analogy with a show that you know and you can get an idea of where we're headed.
Kind of similar to Arthur C. Clarke, where he predicted the advent of satellites way before their time. So as soon as satellites got into orbit, they said, as predicted by Arthur C. Clarke.
Exactly.
Fascinating stuff back from episode 18. The interesting thing is, after that discussion, even today, I look for mythological references in TV shows and movies I see, and not just science fiction. In episode 26, Professor John Lattanzio and I discussed star formation. What's the heaviest element that's been detected in stars so far? Let's hear Professor Lattanzio on this. Where do the neutrons come from?
You have to have a source of neutrons. That comes from the other nuclear reactions in the star.
Okay.
Some of them, for example, carbon-13 plus a helium, makes oxygen-16 plus a neutron.
Okay.
So if that happens, then you've got a lot of neutrons.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can stick a neutron into a heavy element like iron-56, it'll go to iron-57, but then it will eject, the neutron will turn into a proton, thus changing the iron to cobalt, and eject an electron. So now I've got a new element. I've got cobalt.
Mm-hmm.
I've gone beyond iron by sticking a neutron in.
Okay.
Stick another neutron into cobalt,
get another element.
And it will decay into a proton and an electron. You eject the electron, the proton stays, and you go up to nickel. And this is how you make all the heavier elements.
So how far up the periodic table have we seen heavier elements in stars? What's the heaviest element we've seen in a star?
I think we've seen bismuth, lead and bismuth, which is basically the end of the periodic table.
Okay. So,
and one of the theoretical predictions is that that should happen in the very oldest stars. There should be a lot of lead, and that's actually been observed in the last few years.
Okay. So what happens to a star once all the hydrogen becomes exhausted?
Once the hydrogen in the core is gone, then there's no longer any nuclear reactions occurring there,
mm-hmm.
because the nuclear reaction started when they got hot enough to burn hydrogen,
about
10 million degrees.
Once
all the hydrogen's gone, the star's about 10 million degrees, it's not hot enough to burn helium, that takes 100 million. There's no support, so it starts to contract again. Gravity starts to take over. You know, you'll hear people talk about the continuous battle between gravity and pressure.
Yeah.
So the nuclear reactions just forestall gravitational contraction for a while.
A lot of people who talk about science think about evolution. And sure enough, it's a topic that we've covered in BrainsMatter back in episode 30 with Dr. Zachary Moore. Here's a snippet where we talk about why some people still don't accept some basic scientific principles. In most places in the world, evolution is seen as just part of our understanding of the world, such as the knowledge that the Earth is round. Why does the concept of evolution seem to have most of its opposition in the United States, do you think?
Well, I don't think it's any big secret that the vast majority of evolution deniers operate from a religious perspective. It's no sheer coincidence that America contains the bulk of the world's conservative Christians, as well as a majority of people who give credence to biblical creationism in some form or fashion. And I think it's the case that wherever you find theological conservatives in the world, whether they be Christian, Muslim, or Jewish, you're going to find people opposed to the concept of evolution. For example, Australia has a robust creationist community, and their prodigal son, Ken Ham, though from Queensland originally, now lives in the city in which I grew up, the very conservative Cincinnati, Ohio, very near to the new Creation Museum that he's just opened.
Of course, a topic that fascinates a lot of people is relativity, that pearl of wisdom from Albert Einstein. Back around episodes 32 and 33, we talked about special and general relativity with Dr. Adrian Gentle.
Einstein came up with special relativity. I'm not going to comment on that. special relativity he published in 1905, his miracle year. Special relativity deals with moving observers. So observers who are moving in what's known as inertial frames, inertial reference frames. And an inertial frame is basically any reference frame that doesn't involve acceleration.
Okay, so the way I understand that is if I'm on a train and I'm walking forwards at 5 kilometres an hour, my frame of reference is that train. Even though the train might be travelling at 50 kilometres an hour, I'm still moving at 5 kilometres an hour relative to everybody else on that train.
Right. And the train's a good example because that was always the example Einstein used. I guess in 1905 that was the high technology. Presumably now the theory would involve USB or something. I don't know. But the idea is everyone has an idea of relativity in the sense that Einstein means, the idea of inertial frames. And the idea you have typically is what's known as Galilean relativity. Galileo worked out what are known in physics as the velocity transforms between relatively moving observers. In relativity, we talk a lot about observers. By observer, I just mean someone who's got a clock and a ruler. If you've got a ruler, you can measure length, and if you've got a clock and you can tell time, then you're an observer, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, so is Galilean relativity similar to the Newtonian view of adding and subtracting velocity? So say, for example, one person is moving north at 10 kilometres an hour and person B is moving north at 5 kilometres an hour, then person A is moving relative to person B at 5 kilometres an hour. And that is just simple addition of those velocities. Whereas if we talk about it in relativistic terms at high velocities, that's a different story, but we'll get onto that a bit later.
Right, and you're exactly right. That what we think of as Newtonian in that sense is precisely Galileo. Galileo came along and had formulated this before Newton followed up with his, you know, F equals ma, his three laws of motion and gravity, and Galileo set the scene for that. So
he stood on the shoulder of the giant of Galileo.
He did indeed, and going back to the example you gave of the train, if you were standing on the station, you watched the train go by 50 kilometres an hour and you were walking 5 kilometres an hour, then I would look at you on the train and I'd see you moving at 55 kilometres an hour. And that's exactly the common sense way that we understand, you know, relative motion.
Yep.
Einstein was led to a more complex understanding through a series of thought experiments. His initial thought experiment, or maybe not initial, but one of his thought experiments that have always stuck with me, is the idea of looking at a clock. If you look at a clock, how do you get signals about how fast the hands are going around? How do you read the time on a clock?
As you've just heard, we talked about special relativity there. I remember trying to grapple with the concept back in high school and being amazed at how the world around us really did work. Dr. Gentle explained all that extremely well. In episode 41, Dr. Roger Rassool and I talked about the physics of music.
There, in a very abstract way. Great skills.
You mentioned the music there before. I've heard about the physics of music before.
Yes.
And have you got an interest in that in particular?
Oh, I can see this is a loaded question. Are you a musician?
I'm not, but I like listening to it.
Okay, okay. Physicists are left-handed and colorblind, and a lot of them are musicians. So, the music in itself, I mean, like, understanding how music comes about, how it appeals to our emotion. Mm-hmm. Like, I'll give you a strange way of making a connection. A lot of physicists work in medical imaging and studying brain reaction to stimuli. And one of the stimuli you might use to trigger an emotion is music. Yeah, yep. Do you get me? And then studying brain function. So it might be nice if you actually understood the music in the first place a little bit. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And music, I love music because music is so easy at the superficial level to write down. Oh, I'll play a note, A440. Well, yeah. But how you play it, mm-hmm. the nuance, the edges, the blending, yeah. And I think it's great. I have many friends who are musicians and I bore them to tears trying to explain to them a bit of the science behind the music they're making. But when you do actually engage them in that area, they get so excited because you've almost given them something tangible for something that they know
already
how to do. Yes.
So give us an example of some of the things you talk to them about.
Ooh, I met some musicians that I was telling about great software we had, which is fast Fourier transform. Mm-hmm. Now, Jean-Baptiste Fourier, what a great scientist, you know, who, for those who don't know, said that any wave shape can be decomposed into the sum of its harmonic components or individual. And for those of you who are trying to imagine what that means is no matter what shape a wave is, you can work it out into the sum of lots of sine waves. Well, that's great.
And, well, and for those who are a bit younger, a sine wave is basically one of those waves squiggles. That just go up and down.
Yeah, an up and down squiggle. Yeah. You know, it's sort of like if you've got a piece of string and kept shaking it and sending it along the way. As computers get faster and faster, real-time analysis is now possible to the point where rather than looking at just the shape of a wave on a computer, you can look at all of what's called the Fourier components. So that's used often in engineering records and everything else afterwards.
Yep.
But imagine a music teacher trying to tell a student, here's how you should blow the note and it should sound. And then the student says, well, I can hear what you're trying to tell me, but I have no idea. Imagine them being able to see what a good note looks like and what a bad note looks like.
Yeah.
And then they can blow their notes and see whether they can change the sound and the shape to actually resemble a good note. So there's a tangible example.
I also talked to Dr. Rassool about physics and science outreach and went on a tour of the particle physics lab at the University of Melbourne.
Hey, Phil Plait from the James Randi Educational Foundation and Discover Magazine's Bad Astronomy blog here, congratulating the podcast Brain Splatter on their 100th episode. The zombie podcast, yeah. Oh, Brains Matter. Yeah, okay, well, congratulations to them too, whatever.
I even shared a joke with Nobel laureate Professor Peter Doherty back in episode 42.
A man is driving down a country road when he spots a farmer standing in the middle of a huge field of grass. He pulls the car over to the side of the road and notices that the farmer is just standing there, doing nothing, looking at nothing. The man gets out of the car, walks all the way out to the farmer and asks him, "Excuse me, mister, what do you think you're doing?" The farmer replies, "I'm trying to win a Nobel Prize." "How?" asked the man, puzzled. "Well, I heard they give the Nobel Prize to people who are outstanding in their field."
Oh, dear. That's terrible.
It is terrible, but I've got a laugh out of you.
Oh, there's no Nobel Prize in mathematics, you know. But I can tell you a mathematical joke.
Go for it.
Well, there's a mathematical biology conference in the Scottish Highlands, and they're given an afternoon off, and they're off walking along a country road, and they come across a shepherd bringing all his sheep in to a fold to protect them for the night because it gets a bit grim out there. And the mathematical biologist says to the shepherd, "Look, if I can tell you immediately how many sheep you've got in that fold, will you give me one of your sheep?" And the shepherd says, "Yeah, sure. I mean, you can't do that." And so the guy tells him immediately how many sheep there are in there. And he's very, very impressed. And he said, "Well, okay, we had an agreement. Take a sheep." So the guy picks up the animal and he's about to walk off with it. And suddenly the guy says, "Well, you know, if I can tell you who you are and what you do, will you give me back my sheep?" And he says, okay, he says, you're a mathematical biologist, aren't you? He says, yeah, how did you know? He said, give me back my dog.
We love corny jokes here, Brains.
That's a corny joke, yeah. That's actually a joke that was told to me by a leading mathematical biologist called Martin Novak, who's at Harvard.
In episodes 44 and 45, I talked to Dr. Mark Boland of the Australian Synchrotron.
The difference between a synchrotron light source, as this synchrotron is called, it's using the particles to generate beams of light, which is anything from infrared all the way through up to X-rays. Mm-hmm. So it's different from other types of accelerators that people might have heard of, such as the big ones in Switzerland.
So CERN,
yeah. They actually are designed to smash particles together, whereas if I'm doing my job properly, the particles out there barely touch each other. They just keep going round and generating this synchrotron radiation, which is used to do the science experiment.
To the layperson in the street, what is this synchrotron made up of? How does it work? How does it get put together? You mentioned that it generates radiation from the light going around, but then how do you actually do measurements based on that? How do you actually get information out of materials, for example? The CERN example you gave before, where it actually smashes things together, that's fairly easy to understand. You smash things together and then you see what comes out of it.
Yeah.
So in this one, you don't smash things together, so how do you actually measure what comes out of it?
Right, the answer is twofold. Because my job here as accelerator physicist is to produce the beam, I can answer it in terms of how the beam is produced.
Okay.
And then I can answer it in terms of how it's used.
Okay.
So how it's produced is quite simple. You have essentially an old-fashioned TV tube which generates the electrons at the very start of the acceleration process. From that TV tube, you accelerate the electrons up to relativistic speeds over a space of about 10 meters.
Mm-hmm.
And now you've got low energy electrons. You put them into a booster synchrotron, which then accelerates up them to very high energies, up to 3 billion electron volts. And then once you've got those high energy electrons, you put them into a storage ring where they stay for up to 24 hours or more. And as they go around in the storage ring, the electrons generate the X-rays or the light which is used on the samples. So that's the first part of the question. Once you've produced that light, the second part of the question is, well, how do you make measurements with that? What you do is you have a series of devices which focus and select out particular wavelengths of light. So, for example, an infrared beamline will pick out the long wavelength light,
mm-hmm.
and an X-ray beamline will pick up the shorter wavelength light.
Okay.
You then direct that light towards a sample that you are interested to study. So if you want to look at the surface structure of something, you would use the long wavelength infrared light.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you wanted to look at the internal structure of something, you would look at with X-rays.
That was a very involved discussion, and it also included a tour of the facility. And a lot of people were interested in it, given that there was a lot of news about the LHC fairly soon afterwards. Back in episode 49, Dr. Pamela Gay told us all where the name The Big Bang came from. Firstly, could you tell us what is the Big Bang?
Well, it's actually a derogatory name given to the idea that the entire universe, everything, you, me, all of the energy, all of the matter everywhere in all of space and time, emerged from a single point about 13.7 plus or minus 0.2 billion years ago. It was a theory that came out, and everyone was a little bit uncomfortable with it. And in the process of slandering it, it was given the name Big Bang, and the name Big Bang just kind of stuck.
One topic that has been huge in the media lately is climate change. We've had Dr. David Caroli, who shared in a Nobel Prize with Al Gore and other IPCC members, on the show to talk about this topic.
If we look at the concentrations, we can go back to some of the ice cores that I mentioned before, deep cores taken through the ice in Greenland and Antarctica. Look at the concentrations now. You mentioned that Charles Keeling had started taking observations in Hawaii in the 1960s and showed that there'd been clear increases, and they've concentrations have grown dramatically over the last 50 years. But we can all use these ice cores to look at where the concentrations were 100 years ago or even 600,000 years ago in ice ages and interglacial periods. So the first thing we can look at is how did the carbon dioxide variations change between an ice age and an interglacial? And what we find is that for the last 10,000 years, this period of stable climate, carbon dioxide concentrations varied between about 275 parts per million and about 290 parts per million. When there was an ice age, carbon dioxide concentrations were lower, but that was primarily because the climate was colder and that affected the carbon dioxide.
So that was once again kind of like a feedback.
A feedback effect, but not due to human activity. If we look at the carbon dioxide concentrations now, they're 380 parts per million, 100 parts per million higher than at any time over the last 600,000 years.
And that's, as you said before, in the space of 100 years of human activity.
Yeah, that's in the space of 100 years. And we know for absolute certain from a number of different lines of evidence that that increase is almost completely due to human activity.
Okay.
Land clearing, burning fossil fuels, and things like that. It's not natural. So then the question comes, well, okay, but other things apart from greenhouse gases could warm the climate, like increases in intensity of the sun.
Okay, yep. So this hits upon what the Global Warming Swindle Program from the UK, which you were a part of the panel for afterwards, it talked about things like natural warming due to the sun. This is just a natural cycle of climate variation. They said Antarctica is actually getting colder.
Yep.
I mentioned the medieval warming period. I'll stop there. I'll let you answer these.
Let me talk about, if you like, as a scientist, how we would like to, if you like, separate cause and effect.
Okay.
And as scientists, we're taught to analyse observational evidence and carry out experiments.
Mm-hmm.
And ideally, what we would like to do to determine if the greenhouse gases have caused the warming over the last 100 years is take the greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere that have been put in by human activity and wait 100 years and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And then put them back into the atmosphere over 100 years and see what happens. And then take them out again, because we're always taught that one experiment isn't enough. We have to repeat it three or four times. And so after you've repeated this experiment maybe four times over, taking the greenhouse gases out, waiting 100 years, putting them back in and waiting 100 years, we would probably know in 800 years if it really is due to greenhouse gases or not. The only problem is,
we don't have 800 years.
We may not have 800 years, and we don't know how to take the greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere. So this is really a thought experiment. But in practice, it's no good just thinking about it. We've actually got to have tools that can be used to carry out these sorts of experiments. And those tools are complex computer models, mathematical models that represent, based on fundamental physical principles, the motion of the atmosphere and the oceans and ice and all their interactions.
So this is Duncan Galloway from the School of Mathematical Science and the School of Physics at Monash University. Brains Matter is the only science podcast I listen to, and it's the best. Congratulations on 100 episodes. Hope to be featuring in a podcast coming soon.
G'day OG, it's Eric from ErkPod and Channel Erk, channelerk.com. Mate, 100 episodes. Wow. I know how it feels. It feels like such a long time ago that we actually first connected and that you were actually on ErkPod for the first time. I hadn't even done 100 episodes yet. I think I was in the 60s. And now I'm in the 200s. But having said that, you have done a great job. You've exposed me to a whole new world of science, curiosities, and interesting factoids. You know, I am no brain surgeon. I'm no rocket scientist. I'm just an average guy who drives trains for a living and talks about stuff on podcasts. So you've exposed me to many, many things, and the really good thing is that you ask questions, but you also ask them in a way that I can understand, and you get the person to explain it in a way that I can understand. And if they don't, well, you'll make sure that they do. So you've had some really fascinating topics, and I even enjoyed those couple of cricket episodes. But then again, as a frustrated number 11, I'd really love to have an iPod if I was playing cricket these days while I was waiting to bat. But that's another story entirely. Speaking of other stories entirely, I am looking forward to hearing the next 100 episodes. And we'll have to wait and see what those 100 episodes are going to be. Keep up the great work and keep Brains Matter. Keep it thinking on the right track.
And now it's time for listener of the episode. But before I get to that, here's another contribution.
Hi, I'm Daniel Viles from the Obstructing the Field cricket podcast on ABC Local Radio. I'd like to say a big congratulations to this ordinary guy for 100 episodes of Brains Matter. I'd also like to complain that I have never once been the listener of the episode. I mean, really, what have the last 99 listeners of the episode got that I haven't got, huh? Anyway, I hope Brains Matter goes for 1,000 episodes, and at least 120 of those have some connection to cricket. Well done.
Okay, okay, you can be listener of the episode for this show, Daniel. Not because you begged and pleaded, of course. I was always going to have you as the listener of the episode. Really.
In a day and age when common sense is being buried beneath magical thinking and science has lost its appeal, there are some people who continue the good fight for science and reason. Brains Matter is one of those podcasts. An ordinary guy is one of those knights in armour.
On behalf of the Nonsense Podcast, I'd like to congratulate Ordinary Guy on his 100th episode of Brains Matter.
Okay, back to the evolution of the show and some of the topics that we've covered. I talked to Adam Parker in episode 59 on the origins of robots and robotics.
An incredible conglomeration of conflicting emotional responses. And it's very interesting that you go right back in some respects to answer your question. In some respects, science fiction actually helps to create the discipline of robotics. If you look at where the idea of building an artificial human being, for example, comes from, it goes, as far as robotics says, it goes well back into deep cultural roots. We can go right back and look at, for example, we can go back to the first known programmable humanoid automaton, which was a drum-playing humanoid machine, which was constructed by a Muslim engineer in the, I think it was the 1100s, named Al-Jaziri, an incredible engineer, invented all sorts of stuff that were absolutely fundamental for the Industrial Revolution later on. And you
that
go,
reminds
you,
me, yeah. Around about the same time, there was a hoax about a chess-playing computer, or a chess-playing machine, as it was called at the time, and it turned out to be a guy underneath with magnets.
Yes, a lot of automata over history have turned out to be very small people in boxes.
Yeah,
doing things. It's a common theme, and it's one of those themes that comes up in robotics as well, which is the idea of illusion. And Maria, the robot in Metropolis, shows that intensely, where she's physically transformed into the look of a human being and then goes out into society and acts as though that human being has gone completely mad, and thus bringing that human being's reputation to disrepute. There's a lot of paranoia about how robots function, but there's also a lot of desire to have them. Science fiction's been incredibly powerful in that. In fact, if you look at the way that some robotics practitioners operate, they're entirely driven by their experiences with science fiction, and sometimes it can be incredibly powerfully formative. One example I would give you is Cynthia Brazil at MIT in Boston. She's been responsible for designing several interesting systems. The archetypal one that listeners should have a look at is Kismet, which is humanoid but not human. Head robot. It's just the head. There's no body. But it has this capacity to look around the room and engage with you emotionally, because structurally its face is able to mimic all sorts of emotions. And it's a very effective thing when you walk into a room to see this. And it's quite common for people to be taken by this and feel emotional responses in as it looks at them, notices them, tries to engage with them, tries to communicate with them, learns from them, and so forth. And the thing that really strikes me about Cynthia's practice is that in her book describing the building of these sorts of humanoid robots, which I'll include the reference to later down the page, she talks about how Star Wars, which she saw when she was a little girl, was so influential because she saw R2-D2 and C-3PO and fell in love with them. And later, when she met Rod Brooks, who's heading up the lab at MIT at the time, and saw his robotic bugs, she thought, well, there you go. That's the precursor. That's what's going to start R2-D2 being real.
That was a very interesting interview. Not only science, but philosophy as well. In episode 72, I talked to Dr. Orliot Larkham-Kaplan about stem cells. Let's go back and find out again what stem cells actually are.
Stem cells are cells that have the ability to develop into any type of cells that build the tissue. So they have the ability to develop to skin cells, to heart cells, to kidney cells, to literally any type of cells in the body. The origin of stem cells is actually within the embryo. Mm-hmm. When the sperm is fertilizing the egg, we create what we call an embryo, and this entity is starting to divide to two cells and four cells. Then it reaches a stage where it's called a blastocyst, which is like an orange half empty, if we want to call it that way. Mm-hmm. So there is some cells within this structure that have the potential now to develop the real fetus, you know, and in the future when this fetus is implanting in the uterus, then we'll have the development of the organs. All the tissues in the fetus are originated from those cells, which are very limited in numbers to start with, mm-hmm. but then as the fetus implant, their number is increasing, and then they start to go through a process what we call differentiation to become heart, kidneys, liver, skin, and so on and so on.
So how do these stem cells know what type of cells to
right.
become?
There is a continual interaction between the environment and these stem cells. And they actually respond to triggers, to their position, to their timing, and so on and so on. And by this conversation with the stem cells and cells that are not going to become stem cells, they know where to go and what to develop to.
It's Rosemary Marbling here from the School of Mathematical Sciences at Monash University. Congratulations on your 100th show, and may you reach your 1,000th show in the not-too-distant future.
And in a few episodes around 74-ish onwards, I talked to Professor Roger Short about elephants and their plight. And here's a little tidbit that astounded me when he mentioned it, since I had absolutely no idea.
A very good zoologist said, oh, those are nephrosterms. You only find those in aquatic animals.
Yeah.
And so we said, gosh, does this mean that elephants are actually aquatic animals that must have relatively recently come onto dry land?
Yeah, that's what it sounds
like. And that appears to be the truth.
Okay.
And the closest living relative to the elephant is the dugong, of which Australia has mm-hmm. a very large population, or the manatee from West Africa and the Americas.
Because when people talk about manatees and dugongs, that they tend to mentally picture whales because yes. of the sheer bulk of them.
Yes.
But elephants are effectively, in terms of size, the largest land creature.
Yes.
So that makes sense.
Hello, it's Mark West here from the Mr. Science Show, www.mrscienceshow.com, and I'm here to wish the ordinary guy congratulations on the 100th episode of Brains Matter. I can remember the early trial programs that he put together under the names of the adequate guy, the satisfactory guy, the average guy. None of them seem to quite roll off the tongue quite as well as the ordinary guy, but I do like the perspective of science he takes from that of an ordinary punter. And I actually do know his real name, so if you want to know it, get in touch. Congratulations again, and let's do what Mark Waugh never did and score a double 100.
Another topic we've tackled is that of science and sport. Episode 85 had Mark West and I talking about science and cricket.
That's true, you just need to wear a helmet and not get your head smashed in.
Going from medicine and psychology and injuries onto mathematics now, we know that the main aim of a game like cricket is to score more runs than your opponent's team, and the key to this is the batsman scoring runs. And the acknowledged best batsman in history was Don Bradman from Australia, and in the modern era, Sachin Tendulkar from India. But you recently discovered that with both players, both Bradman and Tendulkar, their most common scores have been a duck, or to the layperson, a zero. So how could they have such good averages? Don Bradman was 99.94 and Sachin Tendulkar is in the 50s. How could their most common score be nothing?
It's fascinating, isn't it? It surprised me. I didn't think that their most common score would be zero.
And Ponting has the same stat as well, doesn't he, the Australian captain?
Ponting has the same stat. Indeed, if you look at, and what I did was look at the first 34 batsmen in the test runs list. So that's from Tendulkar down to Bradman. If you look at all their innings, which are 247 innings at the time I did the analysis, the most common score amongst the best batsmen of all time is zero.
Pretty amazing statistic there, hey? One that doesn't seem logical, but the mathematics and statistics back that up. And of course, being an expert scientist can also take you to the movies, as they did with SETI Institute's Dr. Seth Shostak, as he explains in the recent episode number 98. How did they approach you to work on the remake of the film?
Well, I just got a phone call one afternoon from a young woman who said, are you willing to be a consultant for the film? And apparently she had gotten my name from somebody whose name was undisclosed to me. So I assume I was playing second fiddle, maybe fifth fiddle, maybe 27th fiddle. Who knows how many people were asked before I was asked. But they asked.
I think you're being a very harsh critic of yourself there, Seth.
Well, no, I'm not sure that I'm being unduly modest here. I'm sure that's true. But it consisted of several things. One, they wanted me to talk to some of the actors and actresses on the phone just to tell them, how they should behave or what jargon they should use as astrobiologists or whatever. They also sent me the script as it was at that time, and this was about almost a year before the film was released. They wanted me to go through and redline the script, just find bits of dialogue and things that, are facts that were not accurate and let them know about that. And then eventually they also flew me up to Vancouver in Canada, British Columbia, to be on the set with Keanu Reeves and John Cleese and Jennifer Connelly when they were shooting one of the critical scenes where they write equations on the blackboard.
How much red ink did you use on the script to start with when you went through your first pass?
Congratulations to the Brains Matter podcast. We're looking forward to many more episodes and hope that you have a fantastic 100th. Much love from all of us here at the Skeptic Zone.
Okay, and now it's time for the interview with author Dr. Simon Singh. I was lucky enough to speak to him on his recent tour to Australia.
Several years ago, one of my best friends gave me a book for my birthday, and it was called The Code Book. And he followed that up about a year or two later with Fermat's Last Theorem. And I have the author of those books here with me today, Dr. Simon Singh. So thanks for joining me today.
It's my pleasure.
So, Simon, I understand you're a particle physicist originally. Is that right?
I did a PhD in particle physics, and then I suppose I could have stayed on and stayed in the field. It's now a very exciting field with the LHC firing up at CERN and so on. Mm-hmm. But this is about 15 or 20 years ago, and I took the decision then that I wasn't quite bright enough or sharp enough or quick enough to be a particle physicist. I could see other colleagues who were just that bit better than me. So I thought, well, if I can't be a physicist, the next best thing is to write about physics and to write about biology and chemistry and maths and everything else. So I moved into science journalism, and that's sort of where I've been for the last 15 or 20 years.
So the first book I read, and which is your first book, is The Code Book. What
led you to think that that was going to be a great topic to talk about?
I suppose when I started, became a science journalist, I first worked in television.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked for the BBC and I made films and documentaries. And when you work in TV, you have to have a story. You have to have a narrative. You have to draw the audience along. And an historical angle is very good, because if you start historically, you can bring people in gently. You have stories of heroes and villains, and you try and personalize those stories. And so when I moved from TV into writing, I tried to pick subjects that had some of those elements: good narrative, good characters, an interesting history. And cryptography ticks all those boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic history dating back to the Greeks and the Romans, and right through to the Elizabethans and the Victorians and the First World War and the Second World War. And of course, today we live in the information age, and codes are more important than ever before.
Mm-hmm.
So there's then the political angle, the privacy angle. There are fantastic heroes. There are wars and battles and lives that have been won and lost because a code has been made or a code has been broken. So that's why I picked cryptography.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned World War II there. I understand that you have a fair bit to do with the Enigma machine and the program that that has over in the UK.
Yes, well, so the Enigma code was used by the Germans in the Second World War.
And unlike that American movie starring Bon Jovi, it didn't happen anything like that.
Well, it did happen a bit like that, actually. The Americans,
but they embellished it.
They embellished it a bit, maybe could have given the Brits a bit more credit. But the idea is that it's an incredibly beautiful and intricate and complex machine. And the Germans assumed it was unbreakable. But in fact, during the course of the war, first the Polish code breakers cracked the Enigma. They handed on their information to the British, and throughout much of the Second World War, the British code breakers based at Bletchley Park.
And that's where Alan Turing was working.
That's right, the great mathematician, the mathematical pioneer of computing. They were able to routinely crack the Enigma.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore they knew where Hitler's troops were based, where they were being moved, where the supply routes were, and so on, which gave Churchill and the Allies a huge advantage. And I was fortunate enough to get hold of an Enigma machine. There's still a few dozen left.
Mm-hmm.
And
is it one of the original ones, or is it a replica?
Yeah, no, it's an original. It was captured in northern France. It was made actually before the war. And it's now based at Cambridge. I use it from time to time, but I lend it out to the Millennium Maths Project at Cambridge, and they take it around to schools, and they try and show kids that the maths is relevant. You know, it's about technology. It's about changing history. And as I say, today codes are more important than ever before. So it gets shown, you know, across the country. And I think it came to Australia a few years ago during your Science Week, and toured schools around Australia as well.
And I think I was a little bit old to visit those at the time. So, you know, a lot of these stories that you're talking about, and the first couple of books you did, and even the book you wrote about the Big Bang, one of the fundamentals of all of that is mathematics. How do you see mathematics as being the primacy of mathematics, or the beauty of mathematics?
When I was at school, I was pretty good at maths, but I wasn't very good. I don't know, in every school there are probably one or two kids who just get maths, and it's so easy for them, and it's their natural language, and they thrive. But I always struggled, and I always saw maths as what you need to have in order to do physics, which is what I really loved.
Mm-hmm.
And I retained that attitude until I made a documentary for the BBC about Fermat's Last Theorem, which is the most notorious problem in the history of maths.
And that was unsolved for a couple hundred years, wasn't it?
350 years, yeah. I think. A French mathematician claimed he had a proof.
Mm-hmm.
I won't go into the details of what the theorem is, and certainly won't go into the details of what the proof might not be.
Was that the one where he scribbled something in the margin?
That's it. In the margin of his book, he said, "I have a truly marvellous proof, which this margin is too narrow to contain."
Mm-hmm.
So Pierre de Fermat said he had a proof, but he didn't tell us the proof, and then he dropped dead. And then every other mathematician who saw this note said, "We've got to find the proof. We've got to rediscover it." And every mathematician who tried failed. In the 17th, the 18th, the 19th, into the 20th century. And eventually, a mathematician called Andrew Wiles, as a 10-year-old boy in the 1960s, dreamed about solving Fermat's Last Theorem.
Mm-hmm.
And sure enough, about 1995, I'm a bit fuzzy with the dates now, he eventually achieved his childhood dream, and he found a complete proof of Fermat's Last Theorem. So the book, I made a film about it for the BBC, and
Was he the one who said he'd found a proof, but then when people reviewed it, they said he'd made an assumption which wasn't quite correct, then he had to come back?
Exactly spot on, yeah. We a colleague of mine, John Lynch, was wanted to make this film, because when the proof was announced, it was front page news around the world. Literally every newspaper in the world was covering this, and Andrew Wiles was on Larry King, he was on, you know, just everywhere. And so John Lynch tried to make a film, but couldn't get into contact with Andrew Wiles. And eventually he realised that Andrew Wiles was being so evasive because there was an error in the proof.
Mm-hmm.
While the rest of the world was saying this guy's a hero, Wiles himself was very embarrassed because actually turned out there was a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
And he locked himself away for another year and eventually fixed the error.
Mm-hmm.
There's a saying...
Was it an error or an omission?
An error, an omission, a false assumption. I'm not quite sure how we describe it. But there's one saying in maths, which is that a problem worthy of attack proves its worth by fighting back.
Mm-hmm.
And that's exactly what had happened here. Fermat's Last Theorem had fought back and challenged Wiles, but Wiles had showed that he was the true master of the problem, came back, fixed the error, and now the proof is complete. And that's the point at which John Lynch and I went back and said, are you ready to make the film now? We made the film.
Mm-hmm.
I then wrote a book about it. And the book is about the problem, and it's about the mathematics and why people do mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also about childhood obsessions and heroes as well as the beauty of maths.
Mm-hmm. And with the current era of the internet and so on, there's a lot more discussion of science and mathematics and podcasts like we're doing now. Do you think there's a move towards people becoming more literate and aware of that sort of thing, or is it just something that we're perceiving?
I think podcasts are great. I think blogs are great. I think the internet's fantastic. But I think, in general, there's probably a decline in maths. Certainly in Britain, fewer and fewer young people are studying maths to a high level, and physics as well, and the other sciences. And that's a great shame. I think we have some wonderful maths and physics teachers. They're heroic people that create the next generation of mathematicians and scientists. But I don't think we have enough science teachers or maths teachers.
I can totally agree with that.
I went to a school a couple of years ago and I taught physics for a term just to see what was happening. You know, what's the standard of physics being taught? That school didn't have a single qualified physics teacher in the entire school.
Wow.
So if I'd have gone to that school as a bright 11-year-old, keen and hungry for maths and science,
you might have been put off.
I'd have been put off because I wouldn't have had the teacher, I wouldn't have had the enthusiasm, the inspiration, and I don't know what I'd have done. But I wouldn't have been a physicist. And so my fear is that we're actually losing a lot of real talent. And my parents came from India to England so that I could get a good education. Now I think a kind of middle-class family in India probably has a better chance of getting a good education for their child in maths and physics than a similar family in Britain or Europe.
I think some of the top institutions for maths and engineering in the world are the IITs and the IISs.
That's right. I mean, I'm very proud to be British, and Britain has a tremendous history of achievement in maths and the sciences. And I just hope that continues,
mm-hmm.
in spite of what's happening to our education system. Or hopefully somebody will have the guts to kind of turn the education system around, get the teachers we need, encourage them back into the profession, and really re-energise and revitalise our science and maths.
And, you know, speaking of that kind of critical thinking, did you want to tell us a little bit about your latest book?
Yes, I wrote a book about alternative medicine, a very odd subject perhaps for me to write about. But I became worried about some of the claims that were being made by alternative therapists, Reiki healers, reflexologists, acupuncturists, homeopaths, and so on. I saw evidence for misunderstanding among the public, possibly even risks and dangers. So I co-authored a book with Edzard Ernst, who's the world's first professor of complementary medicine. Mm-hmm. And we wrote a book, it's called Trick or Treatment, and the subtitle is Alternative Medicine on Trial. And what we do is we look at the scientific evidence, the clinical trials, which of these therapies actually work. Some mm-hmm. of them do work, and we talk about them in the book. But most of them don't seem to work. Either there's no evidence, there's a lack of evidence, there's negative evidence, they're biologically implausible. Some of these therapies are even downright dangerous. So it's been a very interesting year or two kind of exploring a very different area. Mm-hmm. It's been slightly painful. I'm currently being sued for libel mm-hmm. by the British Chiropractic Association. One issue there is chiropractic and what chiropractors should and shouldn't claim. But the second issue is the one of libel. So I'm currently involved in a campaign to reform the English libel law, because at the moment I think there's a real threat that libel laws could threaten the debate, you know, the kind of debate you may have on your podcast about scientific issues. The way science progresses is by challenging, debating, arguing, and if we can't do that fairly and openly without malice, then we're going to hinder science and science journalism. And so if people want to find out about that, there's an organisation called Sensomat Science.
So if people want to help and contribute to that...
Yes, sign up to the petition. We've got about 15,000 signatures now, including people like Richard Dawkins and James Randi and Ricky Gervais and Stephen Fry, celebrities, journalists, free speech people. But yeah, it's an important campaign, as well as the issue of alternative therapies. There's the issue of the libel laws.
Okay, and on one final note, very important question. How the ash is going to turn out? Oh, English gosh. Versus an Australian here.
So I'm leaving Australia tomorrow. I've had a fantastic 3 weeks, and part of the joy of my 3 weeks here has been the fact that England actually managed to win 8 tests. So I'm glad that I've managed to get out of the country before we perhaps lose the next one, but I'm keeping my fingers crossed.
Right, Simon Singh, thank you very much for your time today.
Thanks a lot.
So, it's been 100 episodes. How cool is that? This is Derek from Skepticality, wishing you another 100 episodes and more. So, have fun out there in Australia. Hope you can make it over here sometime. Have fun. Bye.
And now to some messages from various people. While trying to decide some of the highlights to put into the show, Julie Meaden from the UK said, "They're all good. Thanks, Julia." Although even coming up with this set list took me far longer than I estimated. There was just so much to choose from. Catherine from Melbourne wrote in after episode 99 and said, "Enjoyed your interviews at the YIS event. Congratulations and keep up the good work." And from Christopher Abel in the UK, "I love your podcast. I've learnt so much during the last year I've been listening to this. I love the elephant episodes from a few months ago. Would it be possible to have a show about crocodiles? I've always been fascinated by these creatures. I would love to hear more about them from an expert. Please keep up the great work. It's so fantastic to hear about a range of subjects. Regards, Chris in the UK." Thanks for that, Chris. I'll definitely put that on my topics to cover list. And from Brazil, "Hello, ordinary guy," which I doubt you really are. "I'm from Belo Horizonte, Brazil." I hope I pronounced that right. "And I'm sending this mail just to say that I really love your show. It's one of my favourite ones. Keep the beautiful work on. My best regards, Paulo Ricardo Savino." And another comment from Paulo. "I don't have a favourite episode. I love your interviews and talks. Very informative and elucidative, I must say. Of course, when the subject is directly related to astronomy, I'll stop whatever I'm doing right away. Cheers, my best regards."
"Hi, just to wish you a happy 100th episode from Argentina. I've been listening since episode 87 about science songs. I download the new episodes with the Jewish program on Fridays, and I follow you in Facebook too. I hope to hear another 100 episodes more of Brains Matter. Bye."
Thanks for that, Gerardo. Jerome wrote in and said in relation to his favourite episodes, "For me, it's a toss-up between 75 Dr. Richard Stancliffe for Stellar Generations Part 1 and 81 Dr. Ali Ford, The Introduction to Astrobiology. However, I only discovered your podcast since the beginning of the year and haven't had time to go back to the previous episodes. In skimming them just now, though, the elephants one has piqued my interest. Thanks for that, Jerome. You'll certainly find the shows on elephants interesting, I'm sure. And there's plenty more to go back and listen to as well.
My name's Daryl Carlton. I'm an IT consultant concentrating on the first 100 days of a CIO's engagement in new technology. And brains do matter. It's very important that Australia lift its game when it comes to innovation and thinking. And the innovation research report for the Prime Minister showed that we're doing very badly. And programs like Brains Matter can only improve that and should be required listening in all of our schools.
Thanks to everyone who sent their wishes for this 100th show and, of course, to every single one of you who have contributed to the show in the past. I look forward to your continual involvement in the show. I'll leave you with a quote from Gallagher. Don't you wish there was a knob on the TV to turn up the intelligence? There's one mark brightness, but it doesn't work. Thanks for listening, and bye for now. Oh, and if you wait until after the closing credits, there's a bonus attempt at a comedy sketch from my old radio days. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the Brains Matter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.
And for us, in the meantime, in response to Peter Costello. I can't
sort
keep
of
a
got
secret.
Peter Costello in the mind. Isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. I've got secrets on the brain. So yeah. In response to Michael Wooldridge's health plan, we mentioned this to you before. It was very successful. I guess it was in anticipation of any announcements from the wonderful health minister that we do have.
And they obviously heard our.
They heard
show and they decided to implement.
They heard
Del Shonky's
the message
products.
From Del Shonky a couple of weeks ago, so we thought we'd give them a plug once more since they are our fabulous sponsor. And I'll get into it right now. Ever had one of those "what am I going to do" kind of feelings? Like you've had an accident and you need to go to a hospital, but you know that the waiting list for a public hospital queue is longer than the queue to get into the casino on a Saturday night. You feel better, so much better now. Better than ever, we're together now. I feel right. Sorry. Yes, you'll feel much better if you join Del Shonky Health Insurance. Once you're covered by Del Shonky Health Insurance, you'll never have to wait in a public hospital queue again. Instead, you'll have to wait in a private hospital queue, but the big advantage is that you get the doctor of your choice. Del Shonky has its own range of specialists for you to choose from. There's a Dr. Philip, a gynecologist, Dr. Tinia, a podiatrist, Dr. Wacko, a psychiatrist, Dr. Bleeder, a heart surgeon, Dr. Smacky Bottom, an obstetrician, and Dr. Spock, a guy with pointy ears. And at Del Shonky Health Insurance, there's a range of packages for you to choose from. There's the family package, which for no extra cost covers children under 18 for absolutely everything except for sickness and accidents. Then there's our special singles cover, where if you join before the end of the month, Del Shonky will throw in, as a bonus, 2 free introductions at the Del Shonky Dating Agency. Bonus. And pensioners, we haven't forgotten you either. We'll be most impressed with our geriatrics package. We have 2 specialist doctors, Dr. Youth and Dr. Asia, who are renowned for finding quick and simple solutions to what seem like irreversible and terminal conditions. Yes, the methods of euthanasia are guaranteed to end the suffering instantly. So hurry now and join Del Shonky Health Insurance, because your health is our business. And a very profitable business at that.